Lizzie, basically anybody 12 and under. You want to come up here? Come on. I'm not going to hurt you. You don't have to sing or anything. I'm going to sing. Lizzie. Sit down right here, sweetheart. You don't want to come up here?
Oh, okay.
All right. We're going to sing a little song here, and then, yeah.
Jesus.
Hold on a second.
There you go. Jesus loves the little children. Of the world, they are yellow, black, and white. They are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
Just a simple little song. We wanted to sing that. That's because Jesus does. He loves all the children, and what He did in this verse, these verses that we're going to read here in just a second. Is He brought all the children to Him, and He blessed them. So we're going to start off our service here by blessing all of the children.
Yes.
Your Heavenly Father,
that's great.
We just ask for Your blessing on all of our kids.
Teenagers.
Lord, we ask You to just be with them and to help them.
Yeah.
And Lord God, we ask for Your Holy Spirit to be with us here today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Jesus Christ. Amen.
All right. Just to let you know, I love kids. I think everybody here knows that. They're important to me. When we go to Walmart or Research or wherever and we see kids, I always, especially babies, I always have to, you know, smile at them or something just to get their attention. And they'll smile back, but I just love kids. And, you know, this is one of those things that whenever I see a news story that where something bad has happened to a child, it just really tears me up. And what I want to impress on you today is that kids were important to Jesus. And I want you to see how important that they were. Mark chapter 10. Starting with verse 13. Then they brought little children to Him that He might touch them. But the disciples rebuked those who brought them. But when Jesus saw it, He was greatly displeased and said to them, "Let the little children come to Me, and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of God. Assuredly, I say unto you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter it." And He took them up in His arms, and He laid hands on them, and He blessed them.
Amen.
We're going to have 3 points today that we're going to make. The first one is, receive the children. Jesus received the children. I want you to get a complete picture of what's happening here. The children that were brought before Jesus were small, probably infants, okay? And the reason I say that is because it says young children. Now, the word children there in the Greek version of it, if you look at it, the word means anyone that's 12 and under. So it's basically, you know, from preteens down to babies, and that's a broad term there. But it says young children, and so there's a modifier on it. It probably meant young ones. And in fact, if you look just a little bit, it says that He picked them up in His arms. So we're probably talking about kids that are under the age of, you know, 7 or 8 or somewhere in there. So these are younger, smaller kids that was brought before Him. And this wasn't unusual in the day to have a teacher to bless the little children to come up and bless them. We see this in a lot of Eastern cultures where they would do things like this. Not so much in our culture, we don't see that. But even in the Old Testament, you see plenty of examples of where fathers or teachers would bless children. And so you see that Abraham did it, you see Isaac did it, you see Jacob did it. So they would all bless their children. But as they are bringing these children up to him, the disciples stop them. Now, I want you to think about the disciples for a second, okay? Now, you put yourself in your shoes. Jesus is an important man, okay? He's very important to him. He is very important to his followers. He's just, everybody's following him and listening to him, and everywhere they go, there's throngs and throngs of people, just so many people coming around that the disciples decided, he's too busy for these little ones, okay? But Jesus sees this, and he puts a stop to it immediately. And in fact, if you look in here, it says he's greatly displeased. It says, in fact, in some of the translations, that he had indignation towards it. Now, what that means is that he was really upset, to the point of anger. I want you to get that. Now, anger, we often think of anger as being sinful, but we know that anger is a real thing. It's a real emotion, and handled correctly, it is not sinful. We see Jesus, at one time, he gets upset because of the money changers and all the things that was going on in the church where they were cheating people, and Jesus got a rope, he put knots in it, and turned over tables and whipped some guys, okay? I mean, whipped them with a rope.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's some anger, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's how Jesus reacted, and I think we're talking about a similar emotion here. He said, what are you guys doing? These kids are important to me. Bring them to me.
Amen.
Now, I'm throwing in some words here. Here's what he said. Let the little children come to me, and do not forbid them. And what we miss here, and what we don't understand, is the importance of children to Jesus. For many of you, many generations probably before mine, like my dad's generation, they were thought of as that children were to be seen and not heard. And you probably heard that saying before.
Mm-hmm.
Let me tell you something. I just don't think I can agree with that at all. I don't think that we see Jesus doing that. Children are not to be just seen, but I want to listen to them. I want to hear them. I want to hear what my kids have to say.
Mm-hmm.
I love my kids, and I want them to feel loved. We're on the edge of something really important here. And I think that we could miss this if we don't stop and think about it. Jesus really wanted everyone to understand the importance of children. And you might ask yourself, why? And that's where I want to go to next. Why are children important to God, to Jesus? Well, go back a few slides. Not that one. I might have go to the one with the little hand. There we go. All right. Here's the truth. We are God's children.
Amen.
And in every way that you can think possible, we are like children to Him. Think about it. God, his size. I mean, we're bigger than children, right? Okay? So, God is bigger than us. God is stronger than us. God is wiser than us. God has more knowledge than us. In every way you can think about it, we are like children to God. And if that's true, and if it's also true that Jesus came down to human form to come down to our level, don't you think that we should come down to the level of children? You better believe it. We need to come down to their level.
Yes.
Because God reaches down to us. Go to the next slide. Now, this picture right here is a cloud that was taken, I think it was in Paraguay or somewhere in South America, I can't remember, just recently, not that long ago. And it looks like the hand of God reaching down. God reached down in the form of Jesus to us. Now, this cloud is really just a cloud, but it's still a good reminder of God reaching down and reaching out to us. The whole Bible is a message to us from God.
Yes.
And so if we matter to God, shouldn't children matter to us? You better believe it. And let me tell you a truth that I learned early as a Christian. And really, Jesus said it best, and Paul quoted him, it says, it is more blessed to give than to receive. I forgot to write down my reference there. I think it's in Acts chapter 20, or it's something like that. What I'm trying to say is this. Our church and what we do and how we behave our life and how we do things, it's not about what I want. It's about what the church needs. And the church needs us to love the children like Jesus loved the children, to be welcoming to the children, to receive the children. So the first point was receive the children. The second point is receive as children. Verses 14 and 15 says this, "Let the little children come to me and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of God. Assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter it." We must receive the kingdom as a little child. What does the word as mean? It's a comparative term. So it's comparing the kingdom of God and how to enter it to how children are and how they behave. So first of all, we need to understand what the kingdom of God is. Let's start off and let's go back to Jesus' very first message. And it was the same that John the Baptist had. And that is that repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God, these are all the same thing. Talking about God's kingdom. Now I want you to think about what a kingdom was in that day. Okay? Think about it. Being a citizen here in this country is a similar idea. If for some reason we had to leave this country and had to go somewhere else, like for whatever reason God called me to go to Canada, first of all, Christy probably wouldn't go with me because it's too cold up there. But if we did and I had to, for some reason, become a Canadian citizen, what would happen? Well, I would no longer think of this really as my home in the same way, would I? It's still where I'm from, but it's not home anymore. And if we left this country, we wouldn't care as much about the politics. We wouldn't care about what was going on with the leaders. It wouldn't matter as much to us as it does now. And so the same is true for the kingdom of God. Here's what I want you to understand. If we are a Christian, and being in the kingdom of God means being a Christian, it means being a believer, it means having your faith put in Jesus, okay? So it means taking our affections off of the kingdom that we're in and putting into the one that we're going to. See, we're headed to a new country. We're not there yet. We're still part of that country, but we haven't seen it yet. So to receive the kingdom of God means to long for the kingdom that is to come. John chapter 18, Jesus says this when he's talking to Pilate. My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here. There's a time coming, and how all that's going to work out, we can talk about it another time. But the point is this, that kingdom is coming and it's not yet here. And so we're longing for that other kingdom. So just getting to the point here, Jesus is talking about heaven. How do you get to heaven? You believe, you put your trust in him. Listen, let me tell you something. I want you to understand it. This is important. When Jesus starts talking about the kingdom of heaven, I don't know if there's anything more important than that. This is the most important topic. Matthew chapter 16, Jesus says this in verse 26, for what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul?
Amen.
Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul?
Yep.
There's nothing more important than our eternal resting place.
That's right.
So if it's that important, then we need to listen to what Jesus is trying to say here. It says, as a little child. It's a comparison there. As a little child. So the $64,000 question is, what does Jesus mean by that? What does he mean as a little child? So what we need to think about is how are children different? In what way are they different that we ought to emulate? And so I've got a few things here. First of all, little children are trusting. Right. They trust their parents.
Oh, yes.
They don't worry about what's going on. Right. They say, get in the car. They get in the car and they take off.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe. They don't go fast.
But children are trusting.
Yes, they are.
And they don't care as much about the things of the world. When our kids were little, there's several things that we bought that came in boxes. So they would be big enough to have a pretty good sized box. I can't even remember what it was, but one time we got something that came in a big box that was big enough that I think Chrissy and I both could have got in the box. It was a big box. And the point is, the kids didn't play with the thing that we bought. They played with the box. Why is that important? They don't care about the things. They're not about this world. They're not worried about all the shiny things, and they want to have fun. They want to do their own thing. When we get a package in today, one of the kids will grab the box and they'll cut it apart and turn it into a shield or something. I don't know what they do with it, but they still use the boxes. So those are two things. But also, children want to be like their parents.
Amen.
We're talking about when they're really young here, okay? We're talking about little children. They want to be like their parents.
Oh, yeah.
So we need to do these things as well. How do we do that? We need to follow our God just like a child does. See, there's a man with his child following him there, right in his footsteps, falling right behind him. That's the way that we need to approach God, to follow in his footsteps, to do the same things that Jesus did, to follow his example. Do we follow God like that? Do we trust God like that? Do we care too much for the things of this world? Probably. We need to keep our eyes on God. We need to trust in him.
He is.
So, first, we need to receive the children. Second, we need to receive as children. Number three, we need to bless the children. The last thing that Jesus does after all this is he blesses them. This is the very thing that the children's parents wanted. That's why they brought him there. The problem is today that we have devalued children. Listen, children are a blessing, and we should ask God to bless them. Psalm 127, verse 3 says, "Behold, children are an heritage of the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward like arrows in the hands of a warrior. So are the children of one's youth. Happy is the man who has his quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but shall speak with their enemies in the gate." So instead of having a quiver full, what do we have? We have our 2.5 kids, or sometimes there's a growing trend for people to have no kids at all. And sometimes there's legitimate reasons for that. I'm not saying that there's not. But as a society in general, we have devalued children. Christy and I, when we got married, I wanted to have two kids. I thought that sounded about right. She wanted to have three, so we compromised and had four. Nobody won, right?
We both won.
We both won. That's exactly right. See, children are a blessing, and listen, I love my children and love them like I can't even describe it. The first, when Josh was born, and you have to understand, when Josh was born, he was blue and looked like a alien baby. It was still the most beautiful thing I'd ever seen. I mean, here was this perfectly formed little human being. And even if he was a little bit blue, he was beautiful. And I saw him, and the first thought into my mind, you're going to think I'm just acting crazy, or you may not even believe me, but the first thought when I saw Josh was, there is a God. That was my thought. This is proof of God right here.
Amen.
And the didn't lessen any after that. All the other kids, beautiful creations of God. I love them. I love how God molded them and created them. And today, we're not doing that as a society. Back in the Old Testament days, especially back during the Exodus and that era, there was a bunch of pagans in the area of Israel, of Canaan, that was offering their children up to a god named Molech. Leviticus 18 and 21 says this, "And you shall not let any of your descendants pass through the fire to Molech." Now what they would do, this is the nearest that we can tell, is they had this, they had an altar, and they would, I don't know all the details, but the point is this, that they would burn their children alive. That's what they did. They offered their children up in the fire to their God. Now, Larry just talked about Sunday night, about a place where they were putting their kids up in a tree. Just crazy stuff that was going on that they were doing. Why? Why would you sacrifice your kids like that? But the truth is, guess what? We as a society are doing the same thing. We are offering up our children to success and convenience instead of trying to raise them up and bring them up.
Right. Amen.
And if that's not enough, we're just outright murdering them.
Amen.
And yeah, I'm going to bring it up. The word is called abortion.
Mm-hmm.
And it is murder. And you
yes.
don't think that the Bible don't talk about it? You better believe it does. Exodus chapter 20, verse 13, you shall not murder. It's right there. Also, what about the golden rule? Matthew chapter 7, verse 12, therefore, whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them, for this is the law and the prophets. So, here's the thing. I come before you, and I'm a grown man, but I'm inconvenient. Is it okay for you? Would you want to be killed in that situation? No! Just because you're inconvenient. Sometimes my kids probably think I am inconvenient, but that's a different story. See, it's wrong. How have we come to a point in society where we don't love our children like we should? And what do we do about it? We need to bless the children. We need to receive the children. We need to love the children.
Yes.
So how do we work that out? Well, we as Christians, we need to adopt children. We need to foster children.
Yes.
But most especially, we need to love the children like Jesus did. Brother Larry in the Sunday school class already talking about our vacation Bible school that we had not long ago. And I know where your heart was, Brother Larry, about those kids. The same as mine. Why do we have things like Vacation Bible School?
To teach the kids.
To teach the kids to love on the kids. Now, I can tell you for sure, you know, it was not easy for me. Working downtown Tulsa every day, driving home, and then barely get something down my belly before I have to be up here at the church to get everything ready. I can tell you I was tired and out of whack. And the whole week, Larry said it took him a week to get over it. Probably did me too. It was not easy for me. But it was worth it because the kids are worth it.
Amen. All right.
We need to love the children like Jesus did.
Amen.
This was a Christmas play that we did. I think it was Christmas. Yeah, it must have been. I don't even remember the details, but here we are loving on the kids as a church. That is our job. This is what Jesus did. And so what do we need to do? Love the children, because we are God's children and He loves us. So shouldn't we love the children? We need to make it important to us. If we're important to Him, then we need to make children important to us. We need to help children because God helps us. He helps me through every day. So, let's get to the conclusion of the matter here. We need to love like Jesus.
Amen.
We need to bless the children like Jesus did. We need to receive the children like Jesus did. And we need to trust God like children trust their parents.
Yes.
A few years ago, I saw a video of a newborn baby crying. It was a little girl, newborn. I mean, just, I don't know if the dad had even touched the baby. This is how newborn it is. And so the baby's crying and crying and crying. And the nurse is trying to console the baby, and it's just not doing anything. And the dad starts to speak, and as soon as the dad speaks, the baby hushed. And just looked up at the dad. And then I think it kind of startled him, and he didn't talk for a minute, and the baby started crying again. And then he started speaking again, and the baby stopped, just like that again.
Amen.
What's the point of this? She knew her father's voice.
That's right.
Amen.
Do you know the voice of your heavenly Father? Do you listen to him? Do you hear him speaking to your heart? Proverbs 2 says this, "My son, if you receive my words and treasure my commands within you, so yes. that you incline your ear to wisdom and apply your heart to understanding, yes, if you cry out for discernment and you lift your voice up for understanding, if you seek her as silver and search for her as hidden treasures, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God."
Mm-hmm.
So listen to the voice of your heavenly Father like a child listens to his father.
Yes.
Wow.
Listen to the voice of your heavenly Father like a child listens to his father.
Yes.
You see, God is speaking to us. He is speaking to us through his word. He is speaking to us through our consciences.
Yeah.
He is telling us that we are not following like we should.
Yes.
That's what it means to receive God as a child. To listen to what his word says and to obey.
Yes.
That's what we need to do today. Christy, would you come up here, please? If everyone would please bow your heads. I'm going to ask Christy to play a song.